The time for our leadership is now. It was the United States and the United Kingdom and our democratic allies that shaped a world in which new nations could emerge and individuals could thrive. And even as more nations take on the responsibilities of global leadership, our alliance will remain indispensable to the goal of a century that is more peaceful, more prosperous, and more just. The nature of our leadership will need to change with the times. Shortly after 9/11, that our war is not against Islam. Bin Laden was not a Muslim leader. He was a mass murderer of Muslims. Indeed, Al-Qaeda has slaughtered scores of Muslims in many countries, including our own. So his demise should be welcomed by all who believe in peace and human dignity. I receive this honor with deep gratitude and great humility. It's an award that speaks to our highest aspirations, that for all the cruelty and hardship of our world, we are not mere prisoners of fate. And yet I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge the considerable controversy that your generous decision has generated. In part, this is because I am at the beginning and not the end of my labors on the world stage. Compared to some of the giants of history who have received this prize, Schweitzer and King, Marshall and Mandela, my accomplishments are slight.
You just said something. You used the phrase, a Muslim president. And right. There are a lot of our viewers out there who probably jumped up straight up on their chairs and said, what did he say?
Yes.
And now, and why do you say that?
And I will give you the reason. My wife, Rachel, is Jewish and I'm Jewish. But I'm from America. She's from Egypt. I think like a Christian. She thinks like a Muslim. My wife is an intelligence gatherer for the Israeli government in Kol Israel radio services. Mm-hmm. And she was picking up broadcasts for years before the 2008 elections. And the Saudis were saying, and my wife didn't understand it until later, we will have a Muslim in the White House in 2008. Mm. And the fact is, nobody knew who Obama was before 2008.
That's true.
And he became a senator, I believe, in 2006. He barely served a very short time as senator. And all of a sudden, he becomes the president of the United States.
President to the United States faithfully.
That I will execute.
Faithfully, the office of President of the United States.
In my country. Assalamu alaikum. Candidate for president, but as a citizen. A proud citizen of the United States and a fellow citizen of the world. But the burdens of global citizenship continue to bind us together. A change of leadership in Washington will not lift this burden. In this new century, Americans and Europeans alike will be required to do more, not less. Partnership and cooperation among nations is not a choice. It is the only way, the one way, to protect our common security and advance our common humanity. The walls
between races and tribes, natives and immigrants, Christians and Muslims and Jews cannot stand. These now are the walls we must tear down.
President Obama has committed 30,000 more troops to Afghanistan, but has also announced a withdrawal could begin as early as the middle of 2011. Some in the U.S. are skeptical Obama's new strategy will work. RT's Nastasia Churkina reports.
After months of making up his mind, the U.S. president has revealed his plan for Afghanistan, escalating the war at the fastest possible pace.
It is in our vital national interest to send an additional 30,000 U.S. troops to Afghanistan.
In a speech that...
Miller, stop playing around.
You are now listening to Dancing Beats.
Moment as a photo call of the leaders last night. President Obama shook hands with Libya's Colonel Gaddafi. There's been hostility between the two countries for years over Libya's support for terrorist groups.
Today, the government of Libya announced the death of Muammar Gaddafi. This marks the end of a long and painful chapter for the people of Libya, who now have the opportunity to determine their own destiny in a new and democratic Libya.
We stand at the precipice. The entire world is rushing towards World War III by any measurement or definition. The private offshore banks that dominate Europe and the United States are invading countries all over the Middle East, North Africa, and trying to start a war as well with Pakistan. This is all happening as the world economy has imploded and as the private central banks openly announce a private corporate bank of the world.
That are everything you do know about, very little, but what we do know about him has been anti everything we stand for, and he's in the White House. So why are we surprised? Why are we surprised? So now you turn and realize that for the first time, now see people, when I travel, there's two questions when we have an open Q&A, typically there's two questions we can always ask. Where's American prophecy? Anybody study eschatology recognize that all the major players are clearly identified. America's conspicuous in its absence of mention. So that's a valid area of discussion. And then the second question we often get to the spiritually mature audience to say, why hasn't God judged America? Billy Graham quipped several decades ago very cleverly. He says, if God doesn't judge America, he'll have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, Thomas Jefferson said the same thing back in 1781. He says, I tremble for my country when I recall that God is just and that his justice will not sleep forever. So the point is, why are we surprised? Now, if you're going to start talking about the judgment of God, you quickly discover there's at least four or five kinds of judgment. There's calamitous judgment like Noah and all of that. There's eschatological judgment like Revelation 6 and following and so on. One of his judgments could be called his abandonment judgment. Imagine yourself as Samson on that third visit to Delilah, and when you wake up, you discover that your strength is gone. In a few seconds, you realize that God has abandoned you. Can you imagine how Samson felt as he realized the significance of not being able to break loose like he had before and so forth? The abandonment judgment. That's exactly what Hosea was called to present to the northern kingdom. And God says to him, leave Ephraim alone. He's joined himself to idols. That summarizes the whole indictment of God against the northern kingdom, his abandonment judgment. Now, I have preached for years, 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, forgive their sin, and heal the land. God says, if you do four things, I'll do three. And I preach that. I have to be honest with you, I'm not sure I can anymore. Why? Because there is, when I was redoing our Genesis commentary, I was startled to discover how God's primary jealousy is as his role as creator. not as redeemer. To understand his redemption, you have to have the word of God. So you have an excuse, so to speak, not knowing that. But you do not have an excuse about the creation, because the creation testifies of itself, of him. Psalm 19, etc. So the point is, I was startled to discover that God's primary passion or jealousy, if you want to call it that, is as his role as creator. And I also was startled to discover there is a specific judgment of God that is poured out upon a nation that fails to acknowledge him as creator. I used to read Romans chapter 1, verse 18 to the end, and I thought it was about homosexuality. No, it isn't. Not if you read it carefully. In that passage, starting at Romans 1, from verse 18 to the end, three times in that passage, God says, because they did not recognize me as creator, I, God, will give them over to that which is not convenient. And then it describes homosexuality in terms that you can't read it to a small family, you know, to young people. I mean, it's pretty graphic. The point is, it's not about homosexuality. I always thought it was. No, read it carefully. It's about a judgment of God that God puts upon a culture that fails to acknowledge him as creator. And I'm not talking homosexual. I always looked at it as an individual choice, as my friend Don Perkins pointed out, that's an issue for the individual. Fine. As a collective thing, it's a judgment of God. And so as I read any paper, pick it up, I'm beginning to suspect, I'll say it carefully, I'm beginning to suspect that the judgment of God has begun. Not because of the earthquakes and that stone, no. It's because of, the sin of Sodom and Gomorrah was not homosexuality. It was the public condoning of it, okay? And to see where we're headed, I think you start talking about Jimmy Carter. Yeah. I think it's one of those rare comparisons that I think it's unfair to Jimmy Carter to compare him to Obama, because Obama is a sworn enemy. Obama is a sworn enemy of everything I stand for. And so he's not my president.
Time for our leadership is now. It was the United States and the United Kingdom and our democratic allies that shaped a world in which new nations could emerge and individuals could thrive. Even as more nations take on the responsibilities of global leadership, our alliance will remain indispensable.